eat, drink, be merry, for tomorrow you may die. Oh, that slogan sounds a lot like today, doesn't it? But actually, it would make you think about what life was like 100 years ago. The 1920s brought economic prosperity. It was a time where people had just finished the war and they just finished a pandemic, the global influenza. So life tomorrow wasn't certain. But it was also an interesting time because the way that people got information was very different than today. You see, they didn't have the internet. All their information would come from radio, newspapers, books, or just hearsay. So seeing as though they just wore the one and they were living their best day ever, you see, back then, they were completely distracted by the prosperous times. It makes me think a lot like today. People are completely distracted by prosperity and a false sense of reality. With all that being said, my name's Chris Naugle and this is What Now? What's Next? So that was then and, well, this is now. But if we focus on that was then, those were glorious times. The roaring 20s, and it really makes me think about, I wonder what it was like when they finished that summer, that glorious summer in 1929, which gave way to what we now know was the Great Depression. And the Great Depression happened like that. One day we went from prosperity to the next day. Well, let me tell you a little bit about what that was like. Unemployment surged from under 3 million in 1929 to 12.5 million in 1932, with 25% of the families have no employed wage earners in their family. The average household income dropped by 40% from 2,300 in 1929 to 1,500 in 1933. Families lived in dire conditions, including overcrowded shacks and caves. Families neglected health care, while food scarcity led to reduced milk and meat consumption. The Great Depression also delayed marriages, which decreased births, which brought birth rates below the replacement levels that were required to continue economic growth. And this caused increased desertions, leading to over 200,000 vagrant children by 1940. So why talk about the 1920s and the Great Depression? I mean, that was 100 years ago, right? Well, folks, I talk about it because if you look around, it's almost exactly what we're living today. We are living in an era that largely resembles the roaring 20s. I mean, look around. Everybody's rich, right? Or at least acting that way. I mean, we live in a time where as long as you got a job, you can get a credit card. And when you go back to 1929, everybody was doing the same things. Matter of fact, 90% of all the goods that were bought back then were financed today. All the goods that you enjoy, from your appliances at your house, to your actual home that you live in, to the cars that you drive, to the schooling that you benefit from. All of that is financed by debt. Not only are we running massive records in consumer debt, but you also have a government that is setting new records with, we just turned $34 trillion in government debt. For the first time, we are at a point where many say there's no turning back. We cannot ever repay the debt. Can you repay your debt? And I often think about that period of time, and I always go back to that story about Kennedy getting his shoe shined and the shoe shine boy giving him stock tips. And Kennedy, who is a wise old investor, sat there thinking to himself, if the shoe shine boy is giving me stock tips, well, maybe it's time for me to get out of the market. And that's exactly what he did, or so the story says. Kennedy sold all of his stocks and he made a killing doing it right before the bottom fell out and the Great Depression kicked in. What would have taken for someone to make a decision like that in a time when everything was booming and everybody was prosperous and the shoeshine boys were making good stock tips? Why would anyone sell all their stocks? Well, that would basically be insider information, right? That would be somebody that just has an insight or has knowledge that you don't have or that shoeshine boy didn't have. Well, see, today we have AI, we have internet, we have access to information that they could have only dreamed of having back then. But yet, human emotion is exactly the same. people are still making the same decisions. Emotionally based investment decisions, based largely on emotions and not on actual logic, and definitely not on fundamentals. I mean, look at the things people are investing in today. People are putting money in the S&P 500. It is 2024 today, and the S&P 500 is being held up by the Magnificent Seven, seven stocks. This will be talked about in the future. This will be talked about as to why couldn't people see what was coming. Well, what am I trying to tell you? I'm trying to tell you that whether we look at 1929 or we look at 2024, things look very similar. And this is what it looks like right before a depression starts. I want to give a big shout out to Joe Brown at Heresy Financial. You see, he did that video. This is what it looks like right before a depression starts. And it really, really resonated with me because it's about all the things that we're always talking about. We're talking about the economy and growth of an economy. We're talking about debt cycles. We're talking about how an economy goes from boom to bust. And with that being said, I'd also like to talk about another boom and bust. And I'd like to talk about first the boom, which is where you click the boom called subscribe. And then I want to talk about the bust. Whoa, coming in hot. The soft landing that we're supposed to have happen, which is that little bell above. Smash that bell so that you're notified every time we put out a new video. That's what a soft landing looks like right there. It comes in nose heavy. Yeah, just like that, right. So now let's talk about boom and bust. The boom bust cycle. Now, in order to really explain this, you first must understand how an economy works. And I love how Ray Dalio in the Economic Machine video and Joe Brown in his video explain this. And it's simple. Just think about any small little town. Let's just imagine there's one bank, and then you've got a roofer, you've got a shoemaker, you've got a couple businesses. Now, those businesses and those individuals in that town, since there's only one bank, they all deposit money in that bank. And in a normal economy, the bank would have the money that people deposit that they can then lend back out. Now, let's just pretend fractional reserve banking doesn't exist first. So the bank can only lend out what is on deposit. And when the bank lends all that money out, there's two problems. Number one, the bank can't make any more money because they can't lend any more because they just don't have enough on deposit. Secondarily, if one of those depositors needs their money back, you have a lack of liquidity. So now the banker needs to create liquidity out of somewhere. Enter the fractional reserve banking. The bank decides they want to make more money. And they've got all these amazing pieces of paper, which are the loans that they've made from the deposits that they took in. So they collateralize those loans. They leverage those loans. And they find a bigger bank to lend them money with their loans acting as collateral. So now they literally print money into existence, or they create money out of thin air. They take that piece of paper, which is the loan, and then they loan on that. So now, all of a sudden, when that roofer needs more money, they can borrow money, even if the bank doesn't have that money on deposit. And on we go. So as the bank lends more money, the businesses can grow bigger and bigger. And as the businesses grow bigger and bigger, the proprietors and the citizens of that town make more and more money. Because as one business starts to grow, they can spend more money at the coffee shop, more money at the cobbler and the shoe store. They can keep supporting and buying more goods and services. You see how this works? It works just like it does today. As more money comes into the system, think back to the pandemic when they printed $5.2 trillion. That gave everybody checks, checks of newfound money, money that literally was printed out of thin air. It literally just fell out of the sky. Hey, look, I got some more money. All right, I'm gonna buy those Nike Dunks. Oh, I'm gonna go out and I'm gonna buy that Rolex. Oh yeah, that I'm gonna buy that too. And as they kept spending money because of this newfound prosperity called debt, what they ended up doing is now living a better life. And as they were living a better life, it was a debt-induced livelihood. So that life was primarily reliant on the debt. And as this goes faster and faster, as people make more and more, the price of goods go up. Because as one person is making more and spending more, the goods and services get more expensive. And as they get more expensive, eventually you start to build a bubble. much like today. We have bubbles in just about everything. Bubbles in housing, bubbles in the stock market. Look around, it's probably in a bubble. Well, in this small little example, you're creating a bubble as well. And eventually, somebody loses a job. Eventually, someone doesn't pay one of those business owners and they can't make their payment to the bank. And then the bank can't lend more money and they have to foreclose or they have to then default on a loan. When one goes, it starts a chain reaction, almost a domino effect. As one default happens, another one, and it's a chain reaction, and eventually it comes to a screeching halt. Now, that isn't exactly how it works today because you've got the Fed, and the Fed controls monetary policy, but monetary policy is primarily controlled with interest rates and the printing press. Essentially, more money in the system, lower interest rates stimulates economic activity, but also creates inflation. And as inflation gets higher and higher, they have to pull back the reins, which means they then increase interest rates and they pull the reins back on new monies being printed. And as they do that, it brings things to a screeching halt. And that's where we're at today. They talk about a soft landing, but are we really gonna soft land? Well, if you look at all the signs and you look at all the economic indicators and you listen to Ray Dalio, the answer is probably not. So I just want you to stop for a second. I want you to just look around. Think about the fake riches. Think about all your friends, the people you see out to dinner, all the things you see. What kind of clothes are they wearing? The women have nice jewelry and fancy bags and all the fancy stuff. Are they driving really fancy cars? I mean, could it be that really everybody's just independently wealthy? Or could it be that that's just fake rich? Could it be that they're just buried in debt? Big car loan payments, big credit card bills, big mortgages. It very well could. And all it takes for all of that to just vanish is one person having something happen in their life. Maybe the company they work for downsizes. Maybe the company they work for shuts down. Maybe their business can't survive. You see, that's where we're at right now. And all the cracks in the foundation are starting to show. Let me just mention just a few of them. How about credit card delinquencies? Let's start there. Credit card delinquencies, right now, it's mentioned they're about 2.77%. Now, although that doesn't seem bad, but it's higher than it was in the peak of 2020, right before all the money printing started. You see, an interesting thing happened during the pandemic. When the pandemic happened, they shut everything down. So everybody had to do what? Well, had to do nothing. And as they were doing nothing, what were they doing? Saving money, any money that they got, the checks they got from the government, the stimulus, all that money was savings, and they started using savings to pay down debt. It was interesting because debts started going down at an alarming rate, not alarming, but a really awesome rate. And as debts were going down, I actually thought, holy cow, this pandemic is creating people saving money. People are actually saving 10% of the money that they earn. And not only that, they're taking that savings and they're paying down debts. Maybe this is the turn we've needed. But then all of a sudden, they opened the world back up. The masks came off. And everybody went out and it was party like it's 1999 or party like it's 1924. You pick the era. They went out and they started spending money. It was revenge summer. Planes, travel, everything. And all of that took up the money that they saved. And when they ran out of savings, boy, once a luxury, now a necessity. You've heard that before. They continued to spend. But what did they continue to spend with? Debt. Credit cards, but it was okay because they still had a job. And most people during this last era had a raise. Their money, they were making more money because of inflation. So as they make more, they spend more, make more, spend more. Never thinking that this whole party could just end. Let's look at bank lending standards. It's another sign. Right now, have any of you gone to the bank to try to get a loan? It's a lot harder to get a loan. I know, I just went in and tried to renew an existing home equity line of credit. And the bank ran me through the gamut. They wanted everything. And at the end of it, you could tell the bank just didn't want to lend money. And that's happening. But this isn't the first time that's happened. It happens every other time right before an economic collapse. Don't believe me? Look it up. Check this out. The tightening of lending standards at banks is indicated by a metric exceeding 50, reminiscent of all past recessions, as you can see right here. This is a chart that shows all the bank lending standards, and you can see during all the recessionary periods, it's very easy to go back in time and look at the recessions, look how banks tightened every single time. Not only that, a concentration of commercial real estate loans. So this is an interesting one. Check this out. About 700 US banks are mentioned as exceeding the FDIC's guidance on issuing commercial loans. Like, that's another sign. And not only that, stock market valuations. This is one that all of you should be able to see. Like, things just don't really make sense. How about stock market valuations? Look around at all your favorite stocks. Where are they trading? Boy, their prices are really high, aren't they? But you see, that doesn't make any sense either. See, if you look at a traditional 60-40 portfolio and you look at this chart, the stocks and the bonds, they've reached 130-year high in valuations. But this chart isn't the only time you're seeing that. You're seeing that everywhere. You're seeing that in the Magnificent Seven. It's speculation and probably some manipulation. So when you talk about the boom-bust cycle, all of these make up the boom cycle. Printing money, low interest rates, everybody partying like it's 1999 and just going out there and spending money because the luxuries that they once wanted are now the necessities that they just must keep. And unfortunately, during the boom cycle, as Joe points out in his video, you have things like malinvestments, misallocation of resources, you have all these things that you really can't tell during the boom cycle, all brewing behind the scenes. Decisions that are being made on misinformation or false information sometimes, and it often leads to these investments not being viable in the long run. So when the bust comes, which we haven't really talked about, all of these poor investments start to show their ugly face. You've heard it before, all boats rise with the tide, that's the boom. And also, all boats fall with the tide. So as the tide goes out, you start seeing all of the carnage, all of the bad decisions, and all of it is starting to show its face. Hence, bank failures. Hence, Ponzi schemes. And oversupply. That's all starting to happen, folks. And that's the reality of the situation. And that's the reality of where we're at right now. So if you can't see what's coming, you're just not paying attention. So that probably leaves us to talk about the bust. So if you're thinking about the bust, you're probably like, well, when is that gonna happen? Well, here's the facts. When it does happen, which is already starting to, it'll be too late. You see, the decisions that most of you wanna make are before the bust happens. You wanna basically make sure that you're prepared for when this bust comes, when everything deflates, when stock prices start to fall and home prices start to fall and everything starts to deflate around you, you don't want to be deflating with it. You want to be rising above it. So how do you do that? Well, it's simple. You follow a couple simple laws that have been around forever. First off, start saving 10% of the money you make. Start paying down your credit cards. Start paying down your debts. Stop living this fake rich lifestyle. Start understanding the difference between rich and wealthy. You see, there's a huge difference because the wealthy folks have learned how not to give their money back, which means you gotta understand how to take your profits off the table. Now, this is the biggest thing I see almost every single day. I see people that still are heavily invested in the market. I see advisors pushing their clients to put more money in the markets. Why would you wanna put money in the markets at all-time highs? I know we always go back to, oh, it'll always make money in the long run, but you won't make it to the long run because emotions will kick in. Think back to the 1929 era. Think back to the roaring 20s. Do you think any of those folks thought that they were gonna be without a home? Did any of them think that they'd be on the street? Did any of them think that they'd lose their jobs? Did any of them think that they'd be living in the midst of the Great Depression? Absolutely not. They would have said you're crazy even if you brought the idea up. Just like today, people are in denial. People don't think a bad time can happen again. They think the Fed can just turn it all off. And the Fed has done a really good job of kicking the can. Notice I didn't say stopping it, they kicked the can. They just keep prolonging it. And as they prolong it, they make the bubble bigger and bigger, which means when the bubble pops, it's going to be awful. So get your financial house in order. Stop relying on FOMO for your deciding factor when it comes to investments. FOMO stands for the fear of missing out. You're not missing out on anything by not being in the market. Matter of fact, this is one of those rare times where you can get paid to sit on the sidelines, where you can get paid to not take risk. That's right, interest rates are high because the Fed had to raise rates to curb inflation, which they've been bringing inflation down, but not fast enough. So why not take the safe path? Why take the risk when you're not gonna be paid to take the risk? Now, there's always two sides to every story, and there's always two arguments for this. But really, the only argument that matters is the one you have with yourself. Can you handle a 20, 30, 40, 50% drop in your investment's values? Can you handle your house or your properties going down 10 to 30% in price? Would you make it through that? Or would it be better to sell high and just wait for the opportunity to buy low? Because that's what Warren Buffett says, buy low, sell high, and don't lose money. So with that being said, let me ask you a couple questions. Do you feel confident having your money in the bank? Do you have 6 to 8 months worth of living expenses saved? Do you know your monthly budget? Have you created a budget? Do you feel trapped in debt? What about retirement? Do you feel confident that you're gonna be able to retire when that day comes? Do you constantly find yourself acting on FOMO because you think that opportunity is never gonna come again? And if you answered yes to any of those questions, then click subscribe right now, because I put videos out every single week, videos telling you how to prepare for what's about to happen. And I can't think of a better time in history for you to take back control of your money. But not just take back control of your money, take back control of your money by you learning how to be your own bank. And you know what? With that being said, I got a video that I think you'll like. It's right here. It's called Will You Step Up? The world's got a problem and it creates the biggest opportunity for you. My name's Chris Naugle, and this has been another episode of What Now? What's Next? See you next time.